Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How I Did It, Lessons from the Front Lines of Business, by Harvard Business Review, narrated by Mark Cabus and Susan Larkin.
Introduction. For more than a century, business schools have been developing ways to teach students the basic tools of business, how to create and understand accounting documents, analyze cash flows, and appraise the strengths and weaknesses of strategic choices. These tools, and others like them, can be vital to managers who are starting their careers, but their value typically diminishes as a person's responsibilities increase. The reason is simple. The higher an executive advances, the more likely the job will involve making complex decisions that rely less on tools and more on wisdom. That's especially true for chief executives. According to one rule of thumb, chief executives are never asked to make easy calls. If the decision was easy, it never would have reached the CEO's desk in the first place. It's the hard choices that come one after another, all day and every day. It's not possible to teach the wisdom required to make these decisions, since wisdom is a function of experience, but it is possible to improve decision-making over time by repeatedly observing and simulating decisions made by others. This is why quarterbacks sit in darkened rooms, watching films of opposing teams' defenses. It's why Navy SEALs study after-action reports to understand what went right and wrong on past operations. It's also why, nearly a century ago, B schools, led by Harvard Business School, began using case studies to try to expose students to real-life business problems in hope that simulating and debating the choices made by managers would help aspiring leaders put theory into practice. The essays in this book are a singular contribution to this tradition. Like case studies, they take readers inside the C-suite, but they go further, giving inside detail and perspective about the decisions made by the chief executives involved, told in their own words. Beyond the bona fides of their authors, current and past leaders of companies including Google, Xerox, General Electric, DuPont, Burberry, and many others, the most striking element of these narratives is their candor. The public has a tendency to view top executives as polished, decisive, and infallible, and in fact, some executives work hard to burnish this image. However, the CEOs in many of these essays admit to being uncertain or nervous. They get angry. They screw up. "We spent years trying and failing," writes the CEO of IMAX, describing his 20-year struggle to find a workable strategy. "We were wrong," writes the CEO of McLaren, describing a stroller recall as one of the most difficult times in my business life. "I remember thinking, we're screwed," writes Google's Eric Schmidt, describing his misgivings the morning the company went public. Often, when CEOs agree to share a story with a business magazine, they're attempting to speak to a particular constituency. Their shareholders or potential investors, their customers, or even their employees. But when CEOs write for Harvard Business Review, they're typically concerned less with image or stock price and more with the duty they feel to pass along lessons to a future generation of managers, to provide a sort of virtual mentorship, and in that way to help improve the practice of management. We hope their stories help prepare you for the hard decisions that lie ahead in your career. The Editors. Picking the Right People. Sometimes the best management advice is also the most succinct. On that measure, it's hard to beat one of the core teachings of Jim Collins: first who, then what. No matter what grand strategy a company pursues, Collins argues in Good to Great, Its odds of success are long unless its managers ensure they have the right people on the bus. That's why many of the best executives spend the bulk of their time selecting, developing, and promoting the most talented people they can find, and encouraging the wrong people to opt to spend more time with their families. What's surprising about this work is how much disagreement there is over the right way to pick and groom people, whether entry-level workers or the next CEO. In several of the essays that follow, top executives explain why they disregard the procedures that HR types promote as best practice. One CEO explains why resumes and job interviews aren't a good indicator of potential, and why energetically checking references is the single most valuable way managers can identify real talent. Another boss explains why the traditional horse race for the corner office is a terrible way to pick a leader, and outlines how she spent a decade preparing her single, hand-picked successor for the job. What's clear in all of these pieces is that people decisions loom large among the problems that keep CEOs awake at night, which means getting more of the right people on board can help everyone rest easier. Guilt Groups CEO on Building a Team of A Players by Kevin Ryan. Kevin Ryan is the founder and CEO of Guilt Group. The idea. Companies always say employees are their most valuable asset. Kevin Ryan thinks that few of them act accordingly. He believes a CEO's most important job is managing talent. When I think about starting a business, my view is that the idea itself is worth between zero and very little. Most new companies already have competitors when they launch, and if they don't, they soon will. DoubleClick, where I was CEO from 1996 to 2005, had dozens of competitors within a year of its founding. Guilt Group wasn't the first flash sales company, and Google was by no means the first search engine to come along. Why have these businesses succeeded? It's not the idea, it's the people. Execution is what matters, and execution relies on human talent. Every company thinks it's doing a good job of managing its people. They all say, "People are our most important asset." But most companies don't really act that way. Here's a simple test. Ask the CEO if he or she spends more time on recruiting and managing people than on any other activity. For me, the answer has always been yes. That's a radical statement, so let me qualify it a bit. I don't think this test applies at a small company, say 20 people, where the CEO may be doing a lot of the sales or directly overseeing operations. But at businesses that employ more than 50 people, the best use of a CEO's time is to bring in unbelievable people, manage them well, and make sure the company builds and maintains an A-caliber team. Here's another test of a company's devotion to its talent. Is your head of HR one of the most important people in the company? I spend as much time with our head of HR as I do with our chief financial officer, and I'd never consider having the head of HR report to anybody but the CEO. That role is truly strategic, and the person in it needs a seat at the table. It's clear to the people who work with me that I'm thinking about our talent most of the time. When we sit down for meetings, I frequently ask managers to review every one of their direct reports with me. I want continual updates. I also insist that as the CEO, I can talk with anyone in the company at any time. Some managers prefer that executives check with them before talking with other people. That's not going to happen here. I want to get to know our employees better and to assess their talent and potential. I also want to know if they have difficulties with a manager. I am evaluating talent all the time. Addition by subtraction. Part of building a great team is learning to recognize when individuals aren't working out and then letting them go. In general, managers are not rigorous enough about this. That's a problem, because often the only way to make room for better players is to get the weaker players to leave the organization. Of course, it's essential for people to feel that the process is fair. But you have to be comfortable having a conversation with a low-performing employee that goes something like this. You rank 10th out of 10 in performance. You're probably great, but this may not be the right job for you. We may not be the right company for you. I know you don't want to be in a situation where people think you're the lowest performer. Sometimes we can find a position in the company that is a better fit. Inevitably, the employee will question the judgment. I'm not really the lowest performer. Then I say, evaluating talent isn't a precise science, but it's very rare that multiple managers think you're 10th out of 10 when you're really number 2. Maybe you're number 9. Maybe. But the real point is that I want you to be successful, and I don't think this is the right situation or career path for you. Sometimes I say the person can stay on for 2 months and look for a job at the same time, as long as he or she maintains a good attitude and continues to contribute. Sometimes the person feels burned or negative and needs to leave right away, with some severance. I hold managers to the same standards when I ask them to build a team. Not long ago, a senior person stepped into a new role. I said to him, 5 months from now, you need to have a great team. Earlier would be better, but 5 months is the goal. To do that, you'll need to spend the next month evaluating the people you have right now. I hope they're good, but if they're not, we'll make changes to replace them. If you need to promote people internally, we'll do that. If you need to go outside, we'll do that. You also need to make sure you retain your best people. I'm going to be really disturbed if I see that people we wanted to keep have started leaving your area. In this case, I saw all the signs I didn't want to see. At 4 months, he hadn't filled a couple of key roles, and a couple of good people had left. We had a conversation. Tell us what we can do to help, I said. If you need us to double your recruiting resources, we'll do that. At 6 months, he still hadn't built a great team, so I said, we're done. After he left, people started to come forward and tell us how demotivating it had been to work for him and that they had come close to leaving as well. There are two lessons in that story. One, don't let a bad situation fester. A poor manager can ruin morale and damage a company's DNA. Two, no matter how well you think you know your organization, if you suspect something's wrong, it's probably worse than you imagine. You can't let those situations continue. They're just too destructive. Don't hire him. I don't think there's a science to recruiting, but I do some things differently. The hiring process typically has three elements: the resume, the interview, and the reference check. Most managers overvalue the resume and interview and undervalue the reference check. References matter most. It would be a great experiment to not interview people at all, to hire simply on the basis of the reference check and see what happened. I'm pretty sure that most companies would make better hires if they did that. Resumes are good for establishing basic qualifications for the job, but not for much else. The primary problem with interviews is that it's impossible to avoid being influenced by people who are well-spoken, present well, or are attractive. All sorts of studies show how much appearance drives our perceptions of people. The resume and interview also don't alert you to the biggest potential problems. When someone doesn't succeed in a job, it's generally not for lack of the technical skills. It's because of intangibles that don't come up in an interview. Is he attentive to detail? Does she work well with others? How does he treat his colleagues? References are really the only way to learn these things. The essential traits I look for are success, and passion. The truth is that successful people are rarely let go. They're hired by former bosses in other companies. The presumption is that reference checks aren't worth much because people are scared to say anything negative. That's a valid concern because there have been lawsuits. But the way around it is to dig up people who will speak candidly. Invariably, they're people you know personally or people you can network to find. You can't simply rely on the names a candidate supplies. Admittedly, this is hard if the person is 22 and just out of college, but for someone with 10 or 15 years of experience who has worked at two or three companies, you must have some mutual acquaintances. Search firms do this by making a lot of calls, and we try to do the same thing. We also look at LinkedIn profiles to find shared contacts. A while back, someone called me for a reference check on a guy named Fred. I didn't know the caller, so I was very guarded. I talked about Fred's strengths and weaknesses, but emphasized that I liked him. The next day, a college friend named Kevin phoned me. He said he was calling on behalf of someone I didn't know, a close friend of his, who was thinking of hiring another person who had worked for me. The hiring manager had asked Kevin to get the real story from me. If I didn't know the person making the call, I'd have given a lukewarm response similar to the one on the previous day. But this was a longtime friend asking for my candid opinion. I gave it simply, "Don't hire him." When you check references, you want to have a conversation as frank as that. It can take real effort to find someone who will be straight with you, but it's worth it. We don't always get this right. For one hire, an outside recruiter that helped with the search had checked some of the references. Ordinarily, we try to do this ourselves. The man didn't work out. It was just a bad fit. After he left, I ran into a couple of people I knew, one who had worked for the guy at another company and one who'd done business with him as a banker. I hadn't realized that either of them knew him. They told me what they thought of him, which jibed exactly with our negative experience. Sometimes you don't hear an honest assessment until it's too late. Recruiting is so important that we intentionally overinvest in it. We have 10 full-time recruiters on our staff, a lot for a company our size. We also frequently use external search firms, especially for senior positions. Sometimes a company will leave a low-performing person in a job because managers feel there's a shortage of time or energy to recruit his replacement. I don't want to be in that position. As the CEO, I can't be involved in every hire we make. We hired 65 people last June, and interviewing every customer support person would have been a bad use of my time. Even so, I interview many more people than CEOs usually do. I probably interview at least one person every workday. I also make it clear to my senior people that if they're making an important hire, I'm willing to call the person as part of the pitch. People love hearing from the CEO. "Steve, I haven't met you yet, but everyone thinks you're amazing. Is there anything I can do to help with your decision? Can I fly out to meet you?" They always say no, but the fact that you've offered shows you care. Recruiting is similar to sales, and sometimes the CEO's involvement makes a difference. People talk about certain rules of thumb in talent management. One is that the great people in any company are usually underpaid. That's generally true, and you should skew your compensation system with performance pay to better reward them. Another is that A-level people generally hire other A-level people, but B-level people hire C-level people. I think that's true, too, but for a reason other than the usual one. B players hire C players not because they feel threatened by more talented people, but because most people don't want to work for a mediocre boss. Think about it. Have you ever heard someone say, "I just got offered a job. The person I'll be working for isn't very impressive, but I'm going to take it anyway"? That's not something talented people generally do. Another piece of conventional wisdom is that people leave jobs mainly because they don't like their managers. That's also true. We did exit interviews when people left at DoubleClick, and they were almost always leaving because of a manager. I talk about this with our team at Gilt all the time. If good people are leaving your group, that's your responsibility. I want all our senior people focused on that issue. It's especially important in the internet space, where good people are in high demand and have many choices. I think, too, that the hardest quality to find in a new hire is the ability to bring things to closure. Some people don't realize that analysis is useful only if it results in a decision and implementation. Of all the duties facing a CEO, obsessing over talent provides the biggest return. Making sure that the environment is good, that people are learning, and that they know we're investing in them every day. I'm constantly thinking about that, yet I still don't feel I'm doing enough. If CEOs did absolutely nothing but act as chief talent officers, I believe there's a reasonable chance their companies would perform better. Originally published in January-February 2012, R1201A. Seventh Generation's CEO on Giving Up the CEO Seat by Jeffrey Hollander. Jeffrey Hollander, inspiredprotagonist.com, is a co-founder and the executive chairman of Seventh Generation, a maker of environmentally responsible household and personal care products. The idea. A founder of Seventh Generation describes how he knew it was time to go and how he made that case to his team and his board. It happened 3 years ago, but my memory of the moment I knew I had to step down as CEO is indelible. On the morning after a long business trip to the West Coast, I was returning to the Burlington, Vermont headquarters of the company I had co-founded, Seventh Generation. As I walked through our offices with their view of Lake Champlain and the Adirondacks' distant peaks, I resumed my daily ritual of seeking out associates with whom I didn't regularly connect. By this time, I was struck by a startling realization. People were clicking away at their computers, huddling in conference rooms, or heading out for meetings, and I had no idea what they were working on. The experience unnerved me. As the chief executive, I had long been intimately involved in many of Seventh Generation's inner workings. My team often found my preoccupation with the details both impressive and annoying. I would constantly bird-dog efforts to make our diapers absorb just one more gram of liquid. I'd focus relentlessly on new styles of perforation for our toilet tissue. I worked with our sales director on setting goals for every item we sold, right down to individual distribution channels and accounts. In meetings, I took meticulous notes on each direct report, listing every commitment and project deadline. But something had changed. Even as I shook off the jet lag, this new, discomforting feeling of detachment persisted. Even worse, it escalated. I found myself baffled by two of Seventh Generation's most challenging strategic decisions: whether to sell our household and personal care products at Walmart, and whether to expand the brand outside the United States. For the first time in my career, I was at a loss for answers or ideas. Intellectually, I was in denial. But in my gut, I felt ill-prepared to take Seventh Generation, which in 2007 generated $93 million in annual sales, to its then-stated goal of $250 million. Having steered the company for nearly two decades, I knew it was time to find a new CEO. A difficult transition. Any senior leadership transition is fraught with challenges, none more so than when a company founder abdicates the top job. Each morning, as I sat in silence after my hour of pre-dawn exercise, I'd reflect on executives who had bungled their transitions. Two glaring examples were from high tech. Michael Dell left too early, and Scott McNeely left too late. When Dell handed the reins of his namesake company to a trusted lieutenant, it was the world's largest PC maker. Within 3 years, rivals had clawed away much of Dell's market share, and its founder was compelled to return as CEO. Conversely, McNeely continued as chief of Sun Microsystems, despite the company's stunted growth and falling share price. By the time he stepped down, Sun's eventual sale to Oracle was almost inevitable. But then there's Oprah Winfrey, who announced at the peak of her success that she would leave her iconic show in 2011, causing David Carr to write in the New York Times that her gut intuition about knowing when to say no and when it is time to go is worth studying at every business graduate school in the country. The tangible costs of a bungled transition can run to hundreds of millions of dollars worth of squandered market share and submerged sales. But I was more concerned with avoiding damage to seventh generation's intangible assets. Our associates' spirit and will, our stakeholders' trust, and our company's mission and reputation. Seventh generation aspires to do more than simply grow market share. Its purpose is to inspire a more conscious and sustainable world by being an authentic force for positive change. Profits are the score, not the game. But to fulfill the company's mission, we had to become bigger and more profitable. We needed a CEO who would use our financial imperatives to fuel our social and environmental imperatives, someone few executive recruiters are equipped to find. Not surprisingly, the more I thought about how best to proceed, the more questions arose. How quickly should I move? How public should I be? How would I get the board's support and associates' buy-in? How would I ensure that seventh generation's fierce commitment to social and environmental sustainability endured? Above all, was I doing the right thing? Every family member and close colleague said no. Seventh generation's directors wondered if they were about to lose the best investment in their portfolios. In 2007 alone, I had helped grow the business by more than 40%. Some staffers thought that no one who replaced me would have the same vision and values. Talented people signed on with Seventh Generation precisely because it explicitly promised to be a place where they could summon all their individuality and creativity, the very attributes that many companies insist be left at home. Associates worried that a new CEO would fill the place with corporate drones. My wife fretted that I'd end up at home bored and depressed. Nevertheless, we found a way to welcome the biggest change in the company's history. Last June, Seventh Generation got a new chief, Chuck Maniscalco, who until 2008 had been president and CEO of PepsiCo's nearly $10 billion Quaker, Tropicana, and Gatorade division. I remain at the company as executive chairman. Chuck reports to the board, not to me. And I've been devoting much of my energy to furthering Seventh Generation's mission, vision, and corporate responsibility strategy. No one can predict the future, but early returns confirm that making the transition was the right thing to do. Transition tenets. It was tough to concede that I was the best person to guide our company through infancy and adolescence, but not into full-fledged adulthood. I overcame lots of obstacles by following several transition principles involving community, transparency, mission, and corporate consciousness, all central to building a purpose-driven organization. As I learned through real-world experience, there are also valuable signposts for finding a new CEO. Look unflinchingly at your own performance. For the better part of the past decade, Seventh Generation, with help from the author and consultant Carol Sanford, has been trying to develop its corporate consciousness to make us more sharply aware of how we work and what we want to accomplish. Sure, the phrase exudes a whiff of the mystical, or at least the mysterious, but the idea is inherently tough-minded. Break ingrained habits of thought, kick over stale ideas, and avoid the easy path of simply repeating past successes. In late 2007, when I first seriously considered recruiting a replacement, Seventh Generation was enjoying the best run in its history. In 2008, our sales approached $140 million, an unprecedented 51% jump over the previous year's record sales. To some, it seemed the height of folly to bring in a new chief when the company was performing at its peak. Reed Doyle, a passionate, committed member of our product development team, summed up a lot of people's misgivings when he rose at one of our town hall-style meetings and let me have it. "How do we know," he inquired, "that you won't screw up our success by bringing in some corporate big shot?" Actually, I worried that our success was vulnerable to other threats. Although we sometimes seemed to be moving with relative ease down well-worn roads, we were heading into new territory, populated by bigger, fiercer rivals. The company had historically been only marginally profitable, our significant growth masking our meager earnings. That was no longer acceptable for a company of our size. To compete with the giants of the consumer packaged goods, CPG, industry, we'd have to grow annual sales from $140 million to $500 million and eventually $1 billion and earn double-digit operating profits. As objectively as I could, I assessed my ability to lead Seventh Generation toward billion-dollar growth. Our ERP and other software systems had failed to keep pace with the company's expansion. My lack of interest in logistics was partly to blame for our inability to cut transportation and warehousing costs in half. And my senior managers would describe me as the CEO who never met an investment he didn't like. I saw only the upside, never wanting to dwell on the consequences of investments gone wrong. When I was ruthlessly honest with myself, I couldn't help concluding that my limitations bled the benefits of my staying on as CEO. And I lacked the fire. Only when I began to think about taking on a greater cause, such as helping other companies weave sustainability into all their operations, did my pulse begin to quicken. In the spirit of raising corporate consciousness and to persuade the company's directors, I wrote the business case for my succession and presented it to the board. First, I outlined my greatest value to the company moving forward: to be out in public, increasing Seventh Generation's brand awareness, and advancing our mission of creating a better world for future generations. Next, I argued that my lack of experience running a far bigger company reduced my effectiveness as a leader. Finally, I asserted that we needed a chief executive who knew how to build out a consumer brand while competing with huge CPG companies. My presentation was met with stunned silence. I had shared my plans with a few board members ahead of time, but even they were at a loss as to how to respond to my passionate plea. Then, after a few polite questions, how quickly did I expect this transition to happen? What if we couldn't find the right person? How did I think the staff would respond? The board found its equilibrium and agreed conceptually, though not wholeheartedly, that bringing in a new leader was the right decision. Its members wouldn't commit to a transition, however, until they were confident that we'd found the right successor. I thought that recruiting a seasoned number two executive, a president who would oversee the company's operations but report to me instead of the board, and would become CEO in 1 to 3 years, would make for a smooth transition. But reality has a way of disrupting even the best laid plans. Dare to be transparent. Not long ago, the founder and CEO of another values-driven company covertly recruited a successor, declining to go public until the day the new chief arrived. The sudden, unexpected change lowered associates' morale and productivity and made the new leader's job even more challenging. Secrecy is counterproductive, whereas transparency calms the chatter that so often accompanies significant change. At one of our monthly all-hands meetings, I made the case to the entire Seventh Generation community for why I should step aside. At first, people were skeptical, somewhat scared, and hungry for details. "How would we know that a new chief shared our values?" someone asked. "How do we know the new leader won't come in and flip the business for a quick profit?" someone else said. Will we have a voice in the selection process? And how quickly is this going to happen? Our associates own close to 20% of the company. Thus, I argued, what was best for the business was best for them. More than a few, no doubt, remained apprehensive about the changes to come, as I did. But I updated the staff on the search every 4 to 6 weeks and convened a team of senior and junior associates to meet with every serious candidate. Getting more minds into the mix would help us make a better decision, and we all felt that if the process remained open and transparent, we'd arrive at a good outcome. Make the company's mission central in your search. Seventh Generation is organized around 7 global imperatives, 3 of which are that we work to restore the environment, help create a just and equitable world, and encourage associates to think of themselves as educators dedicated to inspiring conscious consumption. If these goals sound impossibly utopian, that is part of the intent. Defining ourselves as evangelists for social and environmental sustainability sets the company apart. Before we began interviewing, I created a spreadsheet to rate candidates on qualities in 3 categories: essential, important, and nice to have. Most essential was a commitment to fulfilling our mission of deeper business purpose, without which no one would make the first cut. Other must-haves included high growth management experience, demonstrated strategic ability, and leadership capability. Some might argue against my putting values at the top of the list, especially when we were heading into the teeth of a global recession. But I had already seen, in the course of recruiting executives to our senior management team, how our values helped us punch far above our weight class. Ambitious veterans who'd made their mark at heavyweights like Clorox, P&G, and Quaker Oats sought us out precisely because they wanted their work to make a positive difference in the world. Chuck Maniscalco is proof of that. Just 2 weeks after he took over as CEO, he blogged that he had joined Seventh Generation because he was drawn to the company's mission. I am at a point in my life of wanting, almost desperately, to give back, he wrote. But lest anyone think he's a softie, consider this. Out of the 70 candidates we reviewed, Chuck was the only one who wasn't interested in a number 2 job. He made a persuasive case that to take the company where it needed to go, he would have to be the chief executive. I would have to immediately turn over the CEO post and redefine my role at the company. Considering all that Chuck had accomplished and all that he could do for Seventh Generation, I knew I couldn't refuse. The week before Chuck was scheduled to revisit Burlington for a final round of meetings, I convened with my senior managers and put 3 questions to each. Should Chuck be CEO or president? How quickly should we make the transition? What operational responsibilities should I retain for the first 6 months of his tenure? I thought they would ask me to stay at the top for as long as possible. I was wrong. With only 1 exception, each declared that it was time for me to move on. The sooner the better. In their view, the transition was already underway. As I reflected on their recommendation during my drive home, I was both saddened and angered. Part of me felt they'd been deeply disloyal. But at the same time, I knew they were doing what I always demanded: speaking the truth without political considerations. By the end of my half-hour commute, I knew that this 20-year chapter of my life was nearing its conclusion. I had to get ready to let go. I'm now deeply involved in building initiatives to ensure that progressive businesses have more influence in shaping public policy. The most exciting of these is the American Sustainable Business Council, a challenger to the U.S. Chamber of Commerce. Chuck is fully engaged in running Seventh Generation. Time will ultimately tell whether we made the right moves. I believe we did. But I have no doubt that by using the transition principles above, we followed the right path. Originally published in March 2010, R10039. J.
'Xerox's former CEO on why succession shouldn't be a horse race' by Anne Mulcahy. Anne Mulcahy was the CEO of Xerox from 2001 to 2009. The idea. Xerox named Ursula Burns its CEO in 2009, marking the end of a nearly drama-free succession process. That was no accident. The outgoing CEO had spent nearly a decade orchestrating a smooth transition. In early 2007, Ursula Burns and I had dinner at a French restaurant on the Upper East Side of Manhattan. It was quiet and expensive, which was uncharacteristic for us. But we needed a place where we could talk. At the time, Ursula was a senior vice president at Xerox and the leading candidate to succeed me as CEO. We were about to announce that she was being promoted to president and would join the board of directors, a move intended to signal that the CEO job was hers to win. It seemed like a smooth transition on the surface. But it's fair to say that we were arguing behind the scenes, though I'd prefer to call it debating. We were having trouble drawing a line between our roles for the period until she became CEO. We were playing the org chart game, debating who would report to whom and who'd have responsibility for what. Ursula rightly wanted as much responsibility as possible, as soon as possible, so that she'd be well prepared to lead Xerox. As president, she wanted most of the company reporting to her, and that just didn't work for me. We never let our team see that there was conflict between us, but there was, so we called a time out. We asked our CFO to come to dinner and act as a facilitator. We talked honestly about how to provide the best transition experience for Ursula while being sensitive to the fact that it was hard for me to step back and give up power. And we talked about how, throughout the process, we would put the company first. That dinner was just one moment in a long process that ended in July 2009, when Ursula succeeded me as chief executive. Ours was the first woman-to-woman CEO succession in the Fortune 500, and Ursula became the first African-American woman to lead a large U.S. company. I was determined to have a smooth succession because I'd come into the job the wrong way. I'd taken over for an outsider who resigned after only 13 months as CEO. So I wanted Ursula to be as well prepared as she could. I wanted to move little by little, to make it almost a no-brainer when the time came, and that's how it felt. That doesn't mean it was easy. Succession is very difficult, which is why companies so often fail at it. It takes a tremendous amount of discipline, focus, and support to do well. People have no roadmap for the process. They don't know what to expect or how to prepare for it. They also don't realize how hard succession is on the incumbent CEO. It's designed to make you able to go away without causing a big impact, and that doesn't come naturally. Giving up power and accountability is a challenge, but it's essential to preparing the future CEO for the role. Who is this person? Ursula's story is extraordinary, considering her background. She grew up in the projects, raised by a single mother who ironed and did chores to support her kids. Her mother used to tell her, "This is where you're going to grow up, but this is not what defines you." Ursula eventually received a master's degree from Columbia. I first encountered her around 1991. She was serving as executive assistant to a senior Xerox executive, a developmental role for high-potential employees. I was running HR. Ursula stood out. In many meetings, she was the most junior person present, and people in that role are expected to listen and be invisible. Not Ursula. She offered opinions, She challenged points of view. Among the senior team, there was a sense of, who is this person? She was just so vocal. But I liked her authenticity and directness, even if she was a little rough around the edges. During the mid-1990s, I was chief of staff, one level above Ursula. She ran a product development team. During those years, I never looked at her and thought, she could be CEO someday. That's partly because she was young, still in her 30s, but I certainly knew she was smart and courageous, and that she'd do very well at Xerox if she stayed. As Ursula rose in the company, she got on recruiters' radar screens. I don't know how many outside job offers she received, but I do know we came close to losing her around 2000. She'd received a great offer from a competitor, and she was a bit disillusioned with our company. An accounting scandal was just starting to unfold, and business results were tanking. She also felt that Xerox's value system and culture were changing. At the time, we had a relatively new CEO, Rick Toman, who'd been brought in from IBM. Paul Allaire, Toman's predecessor as CEO and one of Ursula's mentors, talked with her about whether she should leave. He told her a management change was likely. Rick resigned in May 2000 and asked if that would give her the confidence to stay at Xerox. She said it would. I became Xerox's president, and a year later I became CEO. I expanded Ursula's responsibilities to include manufacturing and the supply chain. I wanted her to be a significant member of my team, and I also wanted to give her an early signal that I believed in her and trusted her with a big part of the operation. From the moment I stepped into the job, the board began discussing who might succeed me. At that point in 2001, we focused on four candidates and were considering two scenarios. The first was, what if something unexpected happens tomorrow and we need someone really experienced who can step in immediately? The second was, what if we had the luxury of developing someone naturally over a long period of time? Ursula fit the second scenario. She needed more time to develop. Over the next few years, she totally re-engineered our manufacturing and supply chain. By the time she finished, our operating costs were probably a third of what they'd been 5 years before. She also overhauled our product development process. My predecessor used to say that during the 1990s, Xerox didn't launch products, it allowed them to escape. It was true. We brought out only a handful of products in that decade, but Ursula made that her mission, and by 2005, we were introducing 30 or 40 new products a year. She also built a terrific team of people. Xerox had lost a lot of research and engineering talent during the 1990s, and Ursula groomed a new generation of technology leaders. She racked up an impressive list of accomplishments. We had regular conversations about her progress. We're always very direct with each other. There's little subtlety. If I wasn't giving Ursula the assurance she needed, she'd be frank about wanting to be told, you're on track, which meant you're a really good candidate for CEO. There were never any guarantees, but by mid-decade, she was running half the company. In the conversations I had with the other candidates during this time, I tried to be realistic about their status. I don't believe in having people face off against each other for the CEO job in a classic horse race. I know that's the General Electric model, but I didn't want to lose the three players who weren't going to get the job. I sent them honest signals about whether they were lead candidates or not, and what the possibilities would be if they didn't get the job of chief executive, so that they could feel good about their opportunities and the contribution they would make. I worked hard to avoid a contest that would be dysfunctional for the company. Beware the Tapping Pen. Ursula had appeared before the board of directors in the past, but I made sure she had a lot of visibility in the boardroom over the next few years. She was on her feet a lot. That's the formal part of it. But board events also include dinners and lunches, and I would seat her next to the members she needed to get to know. We made sure she had a chance to engage with them at other social events, too, and she did very well. I also tried to work with her on weaknesses. Earlier in her career, she didn't have a good poker face. All her emotions were visible. That's a big thing for a CEO, because everybody is looking at you. You can destroy someone by showing your emotions, particularly negative ones. It just shuts people down. If you come into the office looking like you're having a very bad day, everyone reacts to your mood. As chief executive, you have to consciously set the right tone, and Ursula worked to develop that. I'm not perfect at it myself. My team will tell you that when my pen starts tapping in a meeting, it's time to run for the hills. But CEOs have to manage those unintended displays because of how much impact they have on other people. Something else Ursula needed to develop was an ability to engage her team. When you're really smart and tough and have a lot of responsibility, it can be hard to sit through a long process where everyone voices his or her views, especially if you've already reached a decision. A person like Ursula, who really hates to waste time, can be tempted to cut through the crap and reach a conclusion that seems obvious to her. But it's important to realize that if, as CEO, you make your call too early, your team won't feel that it owns the outcome. The process can seem like a waste of time, but it's important. Ursula is very good at it now, but it didn't come naturally to her early on. Over the years we've worked together, some people have gotten the idea that Ursula and I are close personal friends. We're not. We don't socialize away from work. Our families don't get together. Misconceptions like this seem to be tied to women in leadership positions. People generally don't assume that male executives are best friends. People tend to look for characteristics in women leaders that would make them seem like really nice people and good friends, so that those leaders won't fit the stereotype of ambitious women. But we are good business colleagues, and we've been able to talk honestly and work through difficult issues. At dinner that night in 2007, we debated various scenarios for splitting responsibility. One involved flipping duties. I'd take over the parts of the company she knew well, and she'd take over the parts I was running. It sounded like a good developmental experience, but it was actually a pretty dumb idea. Putting your two top people on a learning curve isn't smart, and the CEO isn't expected to have intimate experience with every piece of the company. Instead, we decided that Ursula would keep her current responsibilities and would take on all the corporate staff except the CFO. I kept customer operations and our geographic regions, with the understanding that she'd spend more time with the leaders of those units. It was a way of not moving too quickly, but giving her access to everything. In some ways, we were saying, we'd run the company together, make decisions together with no definitive line of separation. We arrived at a really good place. Smoothing the path. Under the plan we came up with in 2007, Ursula would have been CEO by early 2009, possibly as early as mid-2008. In fact, it took longer. Xerox had been facing securities litigation since 2000, and I wanted to settle that case before Ursula took over so that she could start with a clean slate. We wanted to get our services business up and running, and to have a roadmap for the acquisition of affiliated computer services. A couple of our senior people were retiring, and we wanted to give their replacements time to get their feet wet, so that Ursula wouldn't have a bunch of newbies on her team. I think she understood that there is no perfect time to become a CEO or to leave the position, but that it would be good to have some of those milestones behind her. By mid-2008, the board had agreed that Ursula would succeed me. This was largely a formality. The process had been iterative. I'd been discussing our progress with directors over breakfast before every single board meeting, and Ursula was present for many of these discussions. The directors weren't still asking, "Is she ready?" or "Is this the right decision?" Their confidence in the answer had been established long ago. At that point, they were concerned with timelines, communications, and how long I would stay on as chairman. Looking back on the process, I think the succession conversation between chief executives and their boards needs to start a lot earlier than might feel comfortable. The board must make sure the discussion gets going. It's unnatural for a CEO to want to initiate it early in his or her tenure, and I think succession should play out over 3 to 5 years at a minimum. So the early and often nature of the conversation is crucial. Your actions have to support your plans. You have to give the candidates developmental responsibilities and visibility with the board. You also need to establish very clear guidelines with regard to timelines and expectations. I've seen lots of companies allow ambiguity on those points, and it's a problem. And although there may be exceptions, generally you shouldn't be CEO for more than a decade. You do a disservice to the company if you don't rotate the leadership. There may be times when a company finds itself with two equally strong candidates who are in a horse race for the job. I'm glad that wasn't the case at Xerox. Having winners and losers isn't good for the company. You wind up losing top talent. Of the three other candidates for CEO back in 2001, one has retired, but two are still at Xerox. If you can develop one very strong player and some peripheral candidates who could be groomed if necessary, and if you can put your energy into making sure that one person is absolutely the best person for the job, you'll be in a good place. By the time Ursula took over, I knew we'd succeeded because I was needed less and less. That came home to me most vividly at a meeting right after she was named CEO. Everyone was looking at her rather than at me. The whole team's attention had just shifted without a lot of drama. That's the way it should be. Originally published in October 2010, R1010A.
Marriott's Executive Chairman on Choosing the First Non-Family CEO by Bill Marriott. Bill Marriott is the Executive Chairman of Marriott International and the author, with Kathy Ann Brown, of Without Reservations, How a Family Root Beer Stand Grew into a Global Hotel Company, Luxury Custom Publishing, 2013. The Idea. For decades, Bill Marriott expected that his son would become the third generation to lead the global hotel company, but gradually he realized that he had to make a different choice. When I became the head of Marriott in 1964, many people were surprised. I was only 32 and had worked at the company full-time for just 8 years. My father, who'd started the business in 1927 with a root beer stand in Washington, D.C., before moving into restaurants and then hotels, had an experienced executive vice president working for him who many thought would succeed him. He was 20 years older than I was, and when it came to finance, he was brilliant. But he was a micromanager. He spent a lot of time marking up contracts, redoing the work of the company's lawyers. He didn't have good people skills and didn't understand the operation of the business. We had a senior director on our board who had been the chairman of three companies, and my father really relied on him. This director came to think that the executive VP was the wrong choice, and he urged my father to make me CEO. After all, I'd literally learned the business visiting restaurants with my father as a young boy, and I'd worked part-time in different jobs at the company since I was 14. My father was worried that I was too young, but Marriott was still small at the time. We had about $85 million in annual revenue, and I think he figured he'd be around long enough to bail me out if I got into trouble. During my decades as president and CEO, the company grew immensely. At the end of 2012, we had 3,800 properties in 73 countries and territories, and our revenue last year was $11.8 billion. While I was leading the company, I often had several experienced non-family executives working with me. If something had happened to me suddenly, those deputies would have been qualified to step in. Some of them were probably viewed as potential successors, but I was in no hurry to give up the job. In 1989, when I was 57, I suffered a heart attack, and I began to think a little more seriously about succession. But I bounced back really quickly. I returned to work after 6 weeks, and I knew that I wanted to stay in the role for many years to come. I have 4 children, and I had always hoped that one of them would succeed me as CEO, just as I succeeded my father. This is an 85-year-old company that until 2012 had had only 2 CEOs, and our family's involvement provides a great sense of continuity. Furthermore, our name is on the door, and that signals a level of personal accountability. I worry that too many businesses today have become depersonalized. We all shop at Target, but who is Mr. Target? Especially in the personal services business, in which the brand is guaranteeing a certain kind of experience. I believe that having someone whose name is synonymous with the brand, who stands behind it and cares about you, is a real advantage. Not all my children were in the running to succeed me. My daughter Debbie is the mother of 5, and although she worked at Marriott as a teenager, she stayed home with her kids for 3 decades. Today she works as Marriott's head of government relations, but she's been in that role only a few years. My oldest son, Stephen, has a debilitating disease. He's blind and mostly deaf. My youngest child, David, is just 39 and a phenomenal executive. He currently oversees all our hotels in the eastern United States, from Maine to New Orleans. He has tremendous potential, but at the moment, he is still learning. That leaves my son, John, who is 52. Like all family members who have joined the company, including me, John started at the bottom, as a cook in the kitchen. He went on to work in nearly every part of the business over the next 30 years. He spent most of his adult life preparing to succeed me as CEO. He devoted his heart and soul to learning the business. If I'd followed my own heart, I probably would have chosen John as my successor. But as time went on, I realized that it wasn't the right fit, not for John and not for Marriott.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.